Hi, I'm Pam, and I'm here to talk about video games. Today, I'm talking about a recently released Metroidvania with a dark fantasy aesthetic. It's Ender Lilies. Ender Lilies, Quietus of the Nights, is an exploratory 2D action platformer that was released in June of 2021 for PC, Switch, Xbox, and PlayStation. I played on Xbox for this review. The Kingdom of Land's End has been destroyed by a blight, and protagonist Lily is the last surviving person with the ability to cleanse spirits of corruption. Lily is also just a little girl. While she's the one you control as you explore the world, it's the spirits she cleanses that do the fighting. From the start, the Umbral Knight attends you and appears whenever you hit the attack button to vanquish your foes. It's a cool visual to see the knight apparate to swing his sword. As you travel and defeat more enemies, cleansing them of the blight, you'll get access to their spirits, who will also help you. It took me a little while to really get into Ender Lilies. I thought the first couple hours of the game were good, but not great. Something just felt a little off. I couldn't really put my finger on it for a while. The spirit abilities had a lot of variety, each screen was full of secrets and fun to explore, combat was challenging, you even get access to double jump very early on, which tends to make everything better. Then it hit me. It was the dodge. When Lily dodges through an enemy to avoid an attack, she throws herself onto the ground and then scrambles back up. This all happens rather quickly, but it feels awkward and honestly, just bad. It kinda put a damper on all the good stuff. Thankfully, after an early boss fight, I believe it can be second or third depending on the route you take, you get a proper dash and Lily stops taking headers into the dirt. Everything fell into place for me after this, and I started really enjoying the game. Ender Lilies is rather challenging. Some of the boss fights, especially around the middle of the game, gave me a real run for my money, and I often had to try them multiple times and adjust the spirits I was using until I found a strategy that worked for me. And there will be a lot of spirits to choose from. The main bosses you defeat wind up being your main attacks. From Knight Captain Julius's quick lance jabs to Dark Witch Aline's fireball attacks that allow you to stay relatively safe at range. Mini-bosses also become spirits you can call on, though they generally can attack only a limited amount of times before they're expended and have to be recharged. These spirits can do things like provide a shield for you, perform area of effect attacks, or summon a familiar who will auto-attack anything within range. While at a bench, which is where you rest and recharge, you can set the spirits you've found to your three attack buttons, and during combat, you can swap between two different setups, which means you actually have access to six spirits at a time. All the combat in the game is based on attack patterns and timing, not only of enemies, but also of your helpers. Though it's technically the spirit doing the attacks and Lily doing the dodging, you still can't do both at once. The attack animation needs to complete before you can dodge away. Slower spirits like Jared, who wields a huge, heavy-hitting hammer, also make Lily less agile. And while I tend to prefer faster movement, his hammer can knock down or stun enemies, so do not overlook him when it comes to boss fights.
It's not just the bosses in Ender Lilies that are challenging. Entering a new area with unfamiliar enemies often kicked my ass. But there were two things that kept this from getting overly frustrating.
For one, you're not really punished for dying. You do have to go back to the last bench you rested at, so you lose some forward momentum. But Ender Lilies, thankfully, didn't go the oh-so-popular route of having to return to your body to get some type of currency, power, or experience back. Though a number of my favorite Metroidvanias use this mechanic, I tend to like them in spite of it, not because of it. Here, if you decide the path that got you killed was too dangerous or you'd rather try a different zone, you can just do it, no corpse run required. But the best thing is that there is a constant sense of progress, even in the areas where I was getting killed the most. The map, which is one of the most important parts of a Metroidvania, is full of secrets. Every screen has multiple things to discover. Even near the start, where you'll have fewer abilities that will allow you to reach high up areas or open locked doors, there are still things to find. You can get items which will increase your health. Fragments, which are the currency that is used to level up your spirits, are all over the place as well. Relics and relic slots are scattered around and allow you to equip little bonuses that help you. There are also notes and lore items to fill you in on the history of this world.
And one of the most rewarding things for me is that there are all kinds of shortcuts. There's nothing like struggling through an incredibly difficult segment only to finally make it through and open up a passage that will let you skip it next time. Feels real good.
Plus, this is a game that involves leveling up, so every kill and bit of experience helps. Since the sense of progress and the secrets you'll be finding are so enticing, this is a game you're likely going to want to 100%. And while the actual map in the menu isn't my favorite, it looks a bit too flowcharty for me, it lets you know which screens still have things to find and which you've finished, which is very helpful. Ender Lilies is also quite beautiful. The color palette of the backgrounds is desaturated, a visual cue of the land's slow descent into blight and death. But when color appears, whether in fields of flowers, the crimson ranged attacks of a boss, or a sword swipe from the Umbral Knight, it really stands out. Each zone has its own distinct look and feel, and it was always compelling to see what environment you'd get to explore next. The soundtrack is similarly engrossing, full of beautiful piano compositions that give the game a melancholy feel. I did occasionally feel like there was a bit too much dialogue and story segments, which happens after each boss or when reaching a new area. It wasn't that much, I just tend to prefer the storytelling for these types of games be more vague and environmental. Especially given that the concept of a kingdom beset by a blight seems really overdone at this point. I can't say this detracted from my enjoyment all that much, though.
Ender Lilies is a beautiful game that I highly recommend. Though it took me a couple hours to really get into it, it ended up hitting all the things I look for in a Metroidvania. It's got a constant sense of progress, a world that is full of rewarding secrets to find, new abilities that make both combat and traversal more enjoyable, and it has a good challenge and sense of accomplishment in the end. My Lily recommends it too.
If you want more Metroidvanias, check out my review of Blasphemous or Bloodstained. I have a Patreon if you want to support the channel. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.